What's the matter, beast? Too kind and gentle to fight back.
Oh.
No!
Bella.
No, Gaston, don't! Let's go, Philippe.
Come on out and fight! Were you in love with her, beast? Did you honestly think she'd want you when she had someone like me?
Get out.
Good stuff, huh? You know, those sisters from Frozen have nothing over Belle and her beast. But that Gaston, probably kind of a nasty fellow, right? Show of hands, who here, every time you watch that, just wishes Beast would just chuck him right over there, right? Right? Just, yeah, get him, right? What does Beast do instead? He shows mercy. He extends grace. Right? And we have to kind of reel our own emotions in right there, and we realize, wow, the beast is kind of a better person there than that we would probably be in that situation. Right? Because beasts fought him, he has him out there, but he pulls him back in. You know, and then we want Gaston to just, we really want him to get it, but, you know, what we don't realize is often we're a lot like Gaston. We don't like to admit that because he's the bad guy, right? And that's not what we want. But what Gaston needs at the end of the scene, what he's begging for, is for Beast to extend him mercy, to show him grace. He begs the Beast for grace, right? Every one of us is like Gaston in the fact that we need every day grace in our lives. The grace of God for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life, first of all. But even beyond that, grace, as we encounter the everyday struggles of life, we need that blessing of grace in our life. And sometimes, you know, we just need it and we want to beg for it. And like Gaston, we're imperfect people, right? So we bring things into our life that we need to have grace shown to us. We mess up. We forget things. We do boneheaded things. Sometimes we even do deliberately hurtful things. Anyone here guilty of any of this today? Already? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Thank you. And in those moments, we need other people to extend us grace, don't we? Just like the beast extended Gaston grace. I thought of an example from my own life, and I thought, I shouldn't tell them this, but I'm going to. It must have been about a year and a half ago. I was driving home from Brady toward my home in Kaler, and a state police officer pulled me over, and I couldn't for the life of me think of why he'd be pulling me over, because I hadn't been I wasn't speeding. I'm like, what's going on? So I pull over, and he gets out of his car. He comes up to my window, and he says, your registration is out of date.
Oh, my.
Well, you should be, because my registration is always in date. It's usually my inspection that's out of date. But my inspection sticker, I was like shocked, and I point to my inspection sticker on my front window windshield, and I say, oh, I've got another month yet, it says. You know, and because I'm used to the registration and the inspection matching, but it didn't. And so I'm sitting there like embarrassed because, you know, and I'm like, oh shoot, I'm going to get a ticket out of all this. And because I was guilty. It was my fault. I had done it. But you know what that police officer said? He said, I'm not going to write this out. I'm not going to log this right away. I'm going to come in tomorrow morning. And if I get into the computer system and see that you've registered your vehicle online before then, I'm just going to let it go. I won't write out a citation. Guess what I went and did right away. But you know what that officer was doing? He was extending grace. You know, I was guilty, but I was shown mercy. And that's grace. That's grace we need every day. It's something we need every day. Every single one of us, every day, gets into places where we need others to extend grace to us. So we know what it's like. We talk about that desperate need for grace. We understand that because we're in a place every day where we need that on one level or another. John chapter 8, if you want to turn there in your Bible, John chapter 8, the first 11 verses, there is an account of a woman who is desperately in need of someone extending grace to her. And what we see going on in that account is the woman is brought before Jesus. Jesus is teaching in the temple courts when his enemies bring him this woman and they say, Jesus, we found this woman committing adultery. Now, you're old enough, all of you. I don't need to explain to you what that entails. But he says, we've caught her. She's guilty. And they say, now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. Now, what do you say? See, notice, there's no question of the woman's guilt. She's guilty. She did it. Right? But what do we do now? Jesus, we need a judgment from you. And at this point, these men who bring this woman to Jesus, they are his enemies. They don't like Jesus. They want to get rid of him. They are threatened by Jesus. They think they've got him. They've got him in this no-win situation because if he says, no, just let her go, well, he's teaching something other than the law of Moses, their highest law, their highest religious law. And so they can bring him up on charges for that. But if he says, stone her, well then, all the people see is an unforgiving tyrant, and they're not going to follow him. You see, either way, they get rid of him, right? Ha ha ha, they got him. But he's Jesus, right? Jesus, just for a while, he just holds off and just saying anything to them. And John writes in his gospel that, you know what Jesus does? He just kind of gets down on the ground and starts writing on the ground with his finger. And every time I read this, who here is with me? Every time you read this, you think, I wish I knew what Jesus were writing right then, right? But John, he just kind of throws this out. Oh, he's writing something. I'm not going to tell you what it was. And you're just like left, what's he writing? But he's just writing there. The whole time he's writing on the ground, these enemies of his, they're plying him with questions. What do you say, Jesus? You got to tell us your judgment. And Jesus finally stands up and he gives him an answer. And he says, if any one of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. Say, any one of you who hasn't sinned, you can be the one to punish someone for their sin. And then one by one, the people go away, starting with the oldest down to the youngest. I guess they just drop their stones and walk away, you know, because they knew. They knew their sin. They depend on God's grace every day. They're not free of wrongdoing before God. And so soon Jesus is the only one left standing right in this place with this woman. And he says, woman, is there no one to condemn you? And the woman, she says, and she's probably full of surprise, no one, sir. Todd, show us this. This is what Jesus says to her then. Then neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. She says, I don't condemn you. What's he doing here? He's extending grace. That's what he's doing. Where there is guilt, Jesus extends grace. Where there is pressure to condemn, Jesus extends grace. Not only that, but you know, remember Jesus was in this no-win situation. How does he diffuse the no-win situation? Extending grace. And extending grace, by extending grace, he causes all the other hard-hearted people, his enemies, they start extending grace as well. They walk away from the woman. You see, the woman, she's in a place, she desperately needs someone to give her grace. I mean, she's been caught, she's guilty, and she's literally in a life and death situation here. And Jesus, he comes and he extends grace. But I want you to notice what grace is not. And just in this last phrase here, go now and leave your life of sin. Grace is not denying that the woman did something wrong. Grace is not overlooking that she's guilty. You know, a lot of people today will tell you, hey, if you want to be a gracious person, you want to be about the grace of Jesus Christ, you just need to accept what everyone does and accept it and allow them to do it as right for them. Oh, I hate that phrase because it is so very much opposite of what Jesus demonstrates for us that grace is. Right? That in no way reflects what Jesus is doing here. He says to her, leave your life of sin. What's he doing? He calls sin, sin, and he lets her know, hey, there's something wrong. He says, I don't condemn you for this, but you're sinning, and you need to stop. So when we talk about extending grace, we're not talking about sweeping sin under a rug or ignoring it, or we're not talking about affirming it. We're talking about showing mercy and showing love when otherwise we might want to condemn or accuse. That's what extending grace is. And many of us, you know, I'm sitting here, you know, you're looking at this Bible passage, if you've turned it in your Bible, and I'm talking to you about it. For many of us, this is a familiar account, right? We've seen this, we've seen it portrayed on TV or in specials or in movies. We've heard people teach on it or preach on it. So this is familiar to us, but I want you today to just kind of step back and maybe do something you haven't done before with this and try to find yourself in this story. You know, who are you in the story? Who can you identify with? I mean, I thought about this, and I think most of us can identify with the woman. Maybe not the adultery part, but the person who needs someone to extend them grace. So, you know, we messed up, and we need some mercy. We can identify with that. She's messed up. She's been found out. She's desperate for a way out. Imagine her fear and shame as they bring her before Jesus, and she's cowering there. Her life hangs in the balance. We've all been there for one reason or another where we felt fear or shame for something we've done. And then imagine her relief and just her overwhelming hope as no one remains to condemn her. We've all felt that before. So we can identify with the woman in the story, those who have received grace. Sadly, we can probably identify with the accusers, right? All too often, sadly, this is the role Christians play. We want to condemn way too often. Forget about grace, we're just going to condemn, or we're going to accuse. We can identify with that. The question I have for us, can we identify with Jesus? Can we do that in this story? I mean, can we identify with being the one who is extending grace? Because we call ourselves Christians, right? Which just means little Christs or followers of Jesus, Christ followers, whatever term you want to use. Which means we're saying we dedicate our lives to following Jesus, to becoming like Jesus, to imitating Jesus. That's what we want to do. Are we imitating Jesus in this mindset of extending grace? Take a look at what it would have been really easy for Jesus just to agree with the accusers, right? Get them off his back. Just agree with them. But he took the harder road of extending grace. He went against the mindset of all those around him. Everybody else was saying, let's condemn her. But he went against that. So he could be that one who was constantly extending grace. Can we identify with that? Is that what we are living to be? Because if we're followers of Jesus, it should be. Are we a people of grace? You know, being a people of grace, that's actually one of our four core values here. Todd, you want to show us? We've been talking about our core values here all summer. And today we get to four out of four. Find this fourth one, which is people. They're important. So grace is extended to all. And that's kind of an abbreviated form. I had to abbreviate them all to kind of get them all in that one slide when we first did that. What our full documentation says, this is a people, are important. So grace is extended to all and expected from all. Grace is extended to all. This is what we believe is one of our values here. First, the grace of God for the forgiveness of sins, for the hope of eternal life. It is extended to all people. This is what God does. We have no say in this. God chooses to extend his grace to all people. I don't care how much you've messed up or how bad you've been or how far into the dark you've gone. God extends his grace to you, to each and every one of us. And you receive it by faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. You receive it by faith, trusting that his sacrifice, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross, is the payment for the penalty of just the places you've messed up, the bad places you've been, the darkness you've created. You trust in Jesus for that, and that brings you peace with God. That brings you eternal life. This is the grace of God, and it's extended to everyone. God says, I extend it to everyone.
And he says, you likewise, go and extend grace to everyone. The second part, grace is expected from all. I guess it's not up there, but it's expected from all. You see, we're all human. We all mess up. Most of us every day, we've already covered that. For that, we need daily grace. Guess where that comes from? It comes first from God. Second, it comes from each other. You get that? That daily grace we need, it comes from us. If every person here expects grace to be extended to them, then every person here has to be one of those people who is extending grace. And so what this means, this congregation, we are going to be a place where people receive grace when they fall short. We don't hold grudges. We don't seek revenge. We don't ruthlessly punish people when they mess up. I found a great illustration of how this works out in the life of a congregation or Christian church online this week. And I want you to read it to you. It says, in the mid-70s, divorce filings and final decrees appeared in the public records section of a community's newspaper. The Reverend Bill Flanagan, a pastor at a local church, read those names week after week and began to see people instead of just statistics. So he created at his church a divorce recovery workshop to offer help and healing in Christ to hurting people during a difficult time. When concerned church people told Bill he was condoning divorce, he softly replied that he was simply extending God's grace to folks in need. See, that's it in action. He's saying, I'm not condoning what they're doing, but I show them mercy. I show them grace. And that's expected that everyone here will extend grace in this manner. See, we don't deny that people mess up. We don't deny that they have to come into some earthly consequences for how we mess up. But as followers of Jesus, we do offer grace when others might want to accuse or condemn. What does this look like? In his book, Putting a Face on Grace, a guy named Richard Blackaby gives us some practical, you know, bullet points, I guess, on what this means. He says, speak words intended to build up, not to bring other people down. Focus on the needs of others rather than your own. Freely forgive. It's not just forgive, but freely forgive. That's the hard part, huh? Swallow your pride and say, I'm sorry and I was wrong. Don't keep score of what is fair. Don't give up on people. Emphasize mercy, not justice, but mercy. This is what it will mean for the congregation, for us, to be extending grace to all and to expect grace from all. And this idea of extending grace and expecting grace from all, it's not really something that's up for debate. You know, some of you might be sitting there thinking, well, this is a great pastor, and you go and do that, but it's not really for me. But it's not up for debate. This is actually a command in Scripture. Todd, show us. In the New Testament, the author of the book of Hebrews, he writes this, see to it that no one falls short of the grace of God. That's what we've been talking about. It talks about the grace of God. Here, this grace of God is the daily blessings that God gives us in each life. That daily, hey, we need grace to get through the day. And we can show to one another. And I love how it says, it doesn't say, don't fall short of the grace of God. Because that's just an individual thing. But it says, see to it. See to it that no one. You know, that word, see to it, there's no mistaking the intent there, right? When someone says, see to it, what is that? That's an action. That's a duty. That's an obligation. That's make sure nobody else is falling short on grace. As an ongoing action, make sure you keep each other from falling short in this grace business. This is what we are reading in the New Testament. This means we're expected to extend grace to everyone else out there. And it means when we see someone among our number falling short on this grace business, we have the duty to point it out to them in love. The in love part is the difficult part. But that's our duty. It's not just I'm being nosy and bossy, so I'm going to, you know, get in your face about something. But it's what we're called to do in Scripture. Like Jesus and the woman accused of adultery. We go to one another and we say, hey, look, I don't condemn you, but here's where you're falling short on grace. You need to turn away from that and stop that. As your pastor, it is my obligation, according to this Scripture, to see to it, to make sure that none of you fall short of the grace of God. It's your obligation to see to it for each other. Now, some of us are falling short, and sometimes we fall short in this, right? This idea of extending grace. Excuse me. Some of us have been carrying around grudges for years. That's falling short of grace. Some of us are very critical of others, whether here or in our lives beyond here. That's falling short of grace. Some of us have been reluctant or downright opposed to seeing beyond someone's past actions to who they are now. That's us falling short of grace. Some of us look at the way other people are living, the decisions they make for their lives, and if their lives are different in any way, or what they're doing, their decision, different in any way from what we have declared must be the right way, it's my way, well, then what do? We write them off, don't we? They're not worthy of mercy and love. We're falling short of grace. We want to be a people of grace. Every day, daily grace. Extending it to all and expecting it from all here. But extending grace, it's not easy, right? Why don't we do it? We don't do it because it's not easy. There is a risk. There's a lot of risk. Right? When we extend grace, what do we risk? We risk other people around us laughing at us or ridiculing us or rejecting us because, well, they want to be the ones who condemn. And you're over here, this goody two-shoes that says, let's show grace. That's what we risk. What do we risk? We risk the people to whom we show grace just taking it and slapping us in the face with it, just walking all over it, taking advantage of us. We risk that. What do we risk? We risk things not being fair. It's not fair I forgive them. They did something bad. No, you don't get justice, but what you get in abundance is mercy. See, to extend grace, we risk a lot, don't we? But we get so much in return. We get so much back when we extend grace. We gain a greater likeness to our Lord Jesus Christ. And isn't that what we are to be living toward? We gain a greater appreciation for the grace God has shown us. And when God forgives us for our own shortcomings, God, the perfect almighty creator, gives us grace. We understand a little bit more how much we are forgiven because we have extended grace to others. And we know what that takes. And here's a huge one. We extend grace to others. We gain the ability to become peacemakers in our own time and in our own place. See, in the encounter with the woman caught in adultery, our Lord Jesus so shows us what happens when you extend grace to someone. Other people around you start extending grace. And what breaks out? Peace breaks out. When we extend grace, others extend grace, and there is peace. And we can all admit, right? We can all agree. One of the things this world needs more of is peace. We can do that. We can be God's instruments for bringing that peace into the world when we imitate our Lord Jesus Christ by extending grace when others might want to condemn or accuse. You know, here at East Brady Baptist Church, people are important. We value people here. And because of that, we extend grace to all, and we expect grace from all. It's one of the things that drives us. It's why we do what we do here. Won't you join us? Let's pray.